Hi, this is Rich Colin, and welcome to our weekly video sessions. This is intended for training only. We're not going to embarrass any officials on the calls that are being made. I think this new format we're using is quite good. Hope you enjoy them.
Starting off this week, wanted to take a look at illegal substitutions and looking at Rule 3.5, Articles 1 through 3. We've got our SCCFOA standard that if the next step takes you off the field for Team B, we are good in this situation. This is a little marginal and the film isn't great because you can't really see the sideline, but you'll have to take my word for it that number 44 and 94 here are just kind of trotting off the field and they are on the field at the snap. Again, this is a little bit marginal, but if the offense doesn't substitute, Team B does not get any privilege to sub their players and they need to get off the field in a timely manner. 353B states that Team B is allowed to briefly retain more than 11 players on the field to anticipate an offensive formation, but it may not have more than 11 players on the field when the ball is snapped. And this is a live ball foul 5 yards from the previous spot. And here's the next clip where you're going to see this defensive player run right in front of the line judge and still on the field at the snap. This is definitely something that we want to flag moving forward for consistency purposes. Again, that privilege of the defense allowing their players to get off the field is only there if the offensive team substitutes any of their players. For our next clip, we want to look at what we would refer to as an incomplete pass. A lot of offenses are starting to run this kind of jet sweep play here because this should be considered an incomplete pass. If this particular back muffs that pass there. So it's a quick little throw up in the air, even if it's not forward. CFO and Steve Shaw put out a bulletin last year that even if this ball is straight up in the air and the quarterback steps back and the running back ends up dropping that forward pass, we want to make this incomplete. We've got a better angle here in the end zone. Clearly shows that this ball is in the air. We want to treat this as an incomplete pass moving forward. Kill the play. Next down. For our next couple of clips, we're going to look at first a legal block below the waist and then an illegal block below the waist. So we know in 9-1-6 that a stationary back lined up with any part of their body inside the tackle box may block below the waist within the tackle box until the ball leaves the tackle box, only if the force of the initial contact is directed from the front. In this particular case, we do see that the back number 9 there is inside of the tackle box. Referees, umpires that are working in the offensive backfield, you know, are you communicating pre-snap, you know, who is legally allowed to block below the waist and if someone is inside the tackle box? But in this particular case, after talking with a couple of folks, this is a legal block below the waist. It is initiated from the front, even though number 9 does kind of turn his body a little bit. That defensive end does have the opportunity to protect himself, which is ultimately the spirit of this rule. So in this particular case, we have a legal block below the waist. And in our next clip here, we're going to look at an example of an illegal block below the waist. And we know, taking a look at the right side of the shield here in the scrimmage kick formation, we know from 9-1-6 that during a down in which there is a free kick or a scrimmage kick, blocking below the waist by any player is illegal except against the ball carrier. We have a really good example here in the end zone. And another quick look here at the right side of the shield, we see B8 and the A player coming in with a low block and then ultimately limping off the field is certainly the action that we're trying to avoid in this case. So we have a live ball personal foul, an illegal block below the waist by the kicking team. Team B can enforce this from the previous spot and re-kick. More than likely, they're going to take it from the succeeding spot 15 yards. Next up, we want to talk about targeting. Had a couple of targeting calls this last weekend. And just wanted to review the aspects of targeting again. We've got 9-1-3 and 9-1-4 in our rule book. So the kind of the checklist that we want to go through is this player defenseless? If the answer is no, and we are not talking about a defenseless player, then the contact needs to be with the crown of the helmet, which was defined for us in 2022 by the 6-inch radius from the apex or top of the helmet. So again, if the player is not defenseless, contact needs to be made with the crown of the helmet in order for this to be targeting. If the player is defenseless, then it's any contact to the head or neck area, which could be with the helmet, forearm, elbow, shoulder, etc. In addition to determining whether or not the player was defenseless and whether or not the contact was made with the crown of the helmet, in 914, there is note 1 where we do need an indicator also of targeting. Those indicators include a launch, a crouch, leading with the helmet, forearm, or shoulder, or the lowering of the head before attacking by initiating forcible contact. So there are a lot of elements to targeting, which is why we'll continue to review it throughout the season, because it is a safety foul, but this also comes with a disqualification of the player. If the player is disqualified in the first half of the game, they remain disqualified for the remainder of that game. If they are disqualified in the second half of the game, they are disqualified for the first half of the next game. And to close us out this week, we want to take a look at a good example of when Team B cannot advance a free kick. You'll see ever so slightly number 0 at about the 20-yard line here gives a quick, valid, fair catch signal, but is not the player that actually makes the catch. So we did miss this on the field. Admittedly, this was my crew this week. The coach did let us know that he saw a fair catch signal, and we were a little bit more diligent about it through the second half of football. But in this particular case, we're looking at AR652 on page FI40, where this ball should be dead where caught. B first and 10 from the 20, so we should have blown this dead. And if B does start to advance this ball like they did in this situation, it could actually be a 5-yard penalty for delay of game. So we will let this B player, you know, catch the ball, take 2 steps, but really not advance it like they are in this particular case, or we want to shut this down, and this is a 5-yard penalty for a delay of game.